the one of the very blessed and noble prophets of God, Jesus. Now let me just move to the four other fundamentals of Islam, purely practices of faith. If you have more questions on the belief, we can always take them later on. I'd like to talk about the five daily prayers. This is the second pillar of Islam. I know that a lot of people, especially when they're in Islamic societies, you probably notice that Muslims are in and out of the mosque every now and then. And you may have the feeling that we pray a lot. If you're not quite sure about the number is five on a daily basis. And I know it can sound like a real huge amount for a lot of people. I remember myself, when I was a Christian, trying from time to time to go to the church, maybe once a week, it was quite of a challenge. And by the time I went back home, then I realized that half of the day was gone. And when I've embraced Islam and I heard that, well, now we people will pray five times a day, I thought, oh, am I going to spend my day in the mosque? Will I have any time to work, socialize, and so on? So I'd like to tell you a little more about the do's and don'ts of the prayer, so you can easily basically understand how it's quite simple to make it fit in any lifestyle, really. First of all, we don't need to go to the mosque for each and every prayer. It's not an obligation. It's better to join a group and to have communion, even if you're just out there enjoying yourself on a picnic. You don't have to leave everything five times a day and run to the mosque. You can pray in the middle of the forest, on the sand, on the grass, in the corner of your office, at home, you know. And you don't always have to meet a group. You could just pray alone somewhere, although it increases the reward to have communion. Sometimes you pray alone and that is valid, because after all the prayer is for your Creator. Now, how long a prayer would take of our time in Islam? You probably think again, in some other religions you go, for instance, to the church, you think, you attend a whole service that may last half an hour and so on. But for Muslims, we do pray within 3-6 minutes. I'm talking here about the basic duties, okay? 3-6 minutes is about the time we need to perform our prayers. It's not a discipline that puts you in like you have to struggle with yourself, not at all. It's a great chance to bring something in your heart. And when you withdraw from the society, and very often you're quite busy doing one of these, you know, important things, like some people may perceive screaming on your neighbor, stuck in the middle of the traffic, headache in the middle of a meeting. You just hear the call to the prayer, you leave everything, you withdraw for just a few minutes. We have actually a special wash that puts us in an atmosphere of worship. First, we put some water on the face. We wash the hands with the forearms, both sides and neck. We wet wipe a little water on the hair, and we wash the feet with the ankles. This is the basic wash, okay? Now, you could add to this rinsing the mouth, nose, and so on. This wash puts you already in an atmosphere of worship. And then you go through the different movements, just 3-5 minutes of your time. It's a great opportunity to rebalance between spirituality and materialism. So if you're sincere in your intention, you just have this great opportunity to go back to humans, to the society, as a more controlled person, and you probably feel a little more of a human. I very much feel like when I'm praying five times a day, because our prayers are not five within 1 or 2 hours, they are spread out, they are spread throughout the day. So every now and then you have this great opportunity to refocus on basic values. We have one at dawn time, and all the prayers refer on the sun's location. So Muslims have to be very much aware of their environment. At dawn time, which is quite early for most people, but actually if you open the window, you'd realize that the birds start already singing. You have the sound of the birds, plants and flowers, and the rest of the creation is waking up at that time. For some reason, probably humans are a little more lazy, we'll sleep a few more hours. Muslims do get up at that time, at least the large majority of them, because they really benefit from something very special by giving very little of their time. And then most of them go back to bed. Anyway. After that, after the sun rises, the whole morning is completely free of duties in terms of prayer. But in the afternoon, it will start again. When the sun leaves its zenith and starts declining, we have the first prayer of the afternoon. With the calculation of shadows, we'll have the second prayer of the afternoon. That's three. When the sun, the disk is completely set, we will have the evening prayer. And when the reddish light in the sky has disappeared, we have the nightfall prayer. Okay? So that's five, and that's every now and then a reminder. I really feel when I'm praying, And I think a lot of Muslims do, at least if you're sincere in your intention. It's basically like, imagine taking a shower 5 times a day, every now and then during the day. It's very difficult for dirt to reach your skin. And this is how you feel when you pray and refocus, and you always go back and thank your Creator every now and then during the day. It should really give you a better balance. And I believe that indeed a lot of people like to keep touch with spirituality. In that sense, it's not a harsh discipline at all. It's just a favor you're doing to yourself. You know, the idea of opening the dialogue is trying to bring people closer together and understand better each other. So if you do have a question, don't be shy. Do you have any question?
What about repentance? Do you have this in Islam?
Yeah, repentance. Repentance also is very different in the religion of Islam. Because very often in other beliefs you hear repentance like going to a third person or doing a certain ritual or, you know, in Islam the door of repentance is widely open, but it has 3 conditions. You don't need to say it in a loud voice. You don't need to inform people about what you've done. But it has to be something really sincere in the heart. First, in sincerity in the repentance and hating what you have done and having the firm intention not to return to it. Now, we humans, we don't know the future. We may fall again in the very same mistake, but at that very moment when you're regretting, you do not have the intention to repeat the sin. So, just with these 3 conditions, it's between you and God. You don't need an intercessor, a man who would give you a so-called absolution, because he may be worse than you do. You know, you don't know what he's capable of. I mean, take an example now. In Australia, they have a new rule. It's just been like, I think, a few years back. Children are not allowed to go to church and get so-called absolution from the priest alone. Why is that? Because there has been abuse on those children. Now, how can you get absolution from a man who's actually maybe going to abuse your child? You know, just, and in Islam, it's really something between you and God, you and your Creator. You ask for forgiveness sincerely with this sincerity, hating the sin, not wanting to return to it. And of course, if you have stolen, then you'll have to repay the money, or whatever you have missed, you'll make up for. But it's very easy to repent, and no one needs to be aware of. Thank you. I have another question. Yes.
I just wanted to ask about sin. Is any sin forgivable and sort of considered to be a sin? I know that's a very wide-ranging question, but there are certain issues in the world today that you yourself have touched on. And I just would be interested to know if everything is forgiven and if...
Okay. So in Islam, you have such a thing as the minor and the major sin. Not wearing the scarf is a minor sin, because it's a requirement, but yet if you don't wear the scarf, it doesn't mean that you're the worst person on earth. Now, killing someone unjustly or, you know, not praying is an important issue. These are parts of the major sins. There's like a category among the sins. It's known that the Creator would forgive any sin at all if the repentance is sincere except one. If we associate any partner to Him, if we do not direct the worship to the Creator, because He's the only one who needs to be worshipped. This is the sin that will not be forgiven unless you repent from it in this life, and then of course you embrace the faith in believing in the unique Creator and accepting the totality of the messengers. That would be a repentance in this life. But the one sin that is not forgiven, and it's written in the Quran, is not accepting pure monotheism, rejecting to basically worship your Creator and starting worshiping something of the creation. Some people are a little surprised about it, but I think nowadays a lot of humans put so much emphasis in human values, and we forget about what is most important. You know, sometimes if you go to someone and insult their mother or themselves, they'll jump up the wall and they go mad. How come you tell me I'm this and that? How come you talk about my mother? I respect her. But then when it comes down to the Creator, for some reason it seems to be less important for some humans. Why is that? Wasn't the Creator the one who created our mother, father, whatever belongings we have? The simple fact of being able to see, the simple fact of jumping out of your bed every morning of your life, we just take everything for granted. Could you stop just 1 second to recognize the beauty that we have? Some people are handicapped, some are blind, some lose their parents. I mean, the first one who deserves to be respected, isn't that the creator of our lives, the creator of everything we owe? I think there is a priority here that people tend to lose touch with, you know, many things they want to respect when it comes down to themselves and what they relate to. But the creator is nice. And I think like some people may work for someone their whole life and then they go and ask the salary to another boss. I mean, direct your worship to the creator of the universe is the duty a human has to understand the real meaning of life. And this is the one thing in Islam that will not be forgiven. Because we put so much effort in looking for the best university when we want to study, and so much effort in looking for a very nice, trendy pair of shoes when you need strong, comfortable shoes. But when it comes down to religions, like, you know, I was born into this and really I'm not really convinced, but, you know, we'll just carry on with the life. And we believe that there is an emphasis in that point. Okay? Yeah.
Usually when you see people praying at the mosque, you don't find any woman between. Is it just for men, the mosques, or are there special mosques for women? That's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, well, the question is about women coming to the mosque, praying all together. It's true that actually for a lot of the questions related to maybe some misconceptions of Islam, the first thing we need to do is to separate culture and religion. Okay, women are not forbidden in a mosque. They're most welcome. They could come and pray here. But it's just that in some areas, in some countries, women do not go so much to the mosque or not at all. Myself, I was surprised when I came to this country and once I didn't have time to go back home to pray. I stopped and I couldn't see any females. So if you go to Syria or if you go to Turkey or, you know, different countries, not in the Gulf area, you would see a lot of women actually going to the mosque. And this is very much here related to the culture. Males and females are separated because this is part of the culture. It's not a denigration for females at all. It's a choice of both parties in the Gulf area that men and women, because of the culture, they socialize, they're separated. And of course it could reflect on the place of worship. Here, for instance, in this mosque, the door you have up in there, you know, there's the wooden door over there, will bring you to the ladies' section. And this is where females would pray if they come, but they rarely come. And this is the culture. In the time of Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, we didn't have such a thing as separation. Men and women would pray in the very same room. They would share the same space. And until now, around the Kaaba, you know, the city construction, you don't have such a thing as men and women separated. Maybe the people now there, they try to put kind of a curtain, but this was not there in the time of our Prophet. So in Islam, there's nothing wrong in sharing the same space to pray. Now, there is something that I need to tell you, is that women would have the same reward by praying at home than men would have by praying at the mosque. And it has nothing to do with women are forbidden to go outside or they're less or whatsoever. It's just that altogether in any society, you probably realize that when people become adults, very often they do get married. When they are married, they do have children. What happens is that very often the mother would like to stay with the children and the father would be very often busy outside. So it's quite challenging for a man to go back 5 times a day to the home. It's so much easier to meet the rest of the men in the mosque closer to his work. Now, can you just imagine a woman, especially with the weather conditions like in this country, having to leave her house 5 times a day, every now and then, with full package of pampers, bottles, and the 5, I don't know how many children. It's just not practical. It's just so much easier for her to stay in the intimacy of her home and pray right there. But that doesn't make her not welcome in a mosque or forbidden. Okay? Thank you.
Well, that's all for today. Please be with us next week for the 3rd and 4th pillar of Islam with some more questions of our guests here in the Jumeirah Mosque.